G'day folks, it's Phil from 15 Minute Guitar Practice here, how you doing? Today, I have a question for you. What does a minor 7 flat 5 chord, a diminished 7th chord, a 7 sharp 5 chord, and a 7 sharp 9 chord all have in common? Well, the answer is that you're not using any of them to play the blues. Now, why are you not using them? Well, same reason most people don't use stuff, because they don't know how to use it or when to use it. But in today's lesson, we're going to take a look at all these weird sounding and weird named chords and how you can use them in the context of your blues playing. So let's jump in and take a look right now. Before we get too deeply into some of the weirder named chords, I want to talk about seventh chords. These are the chords we're playing when we're playing our 12-bar blues. And you may also be playing ninth chord. You also may have discovered that you can swap out a seventh chord for a ninth chord at any point in our 1-4-5 progression. But do you know why that's possible? Why can we swap a seventh for a ninth? Well, the answer is to do with the way the chord is constructed. A ninth chord is a 5-note chord, and a seventh chord is a 4-note chord. But guess what? Out of the 5 notes in a ninth chord, 4 of them are actually the full seventh chord. Have a listen. Here are the notes of a D7 chord. 4 notes. And here are the notes in a D9 chord. Exactly the same, apart from that one extra note. And that's why you can use them interchangeably. And the same goes for all the extended chords. So the same rules apply between ninth chords and 11th chords, for example, and 11th chords and 13th chords. Now, I'm not going to go deep on this here today, but if you are interested in understanding these extended chords, the 11ths and the 13ths, and also the weird named chords, how you can use them, when you can use them, what they're made of in terms of their ingredients, then check out my new course, Complete Chord Clarity. So let's press on with the chords we can use for the blues. So our first chord to take a look at is the Hendrix chord, better known as the 7 sharp 9 chord. Now, why has it got this weird name? 7 sharp 9. Well, if you look at the pieces of it, it has this seventh shape. This is an open D7, which you'll be familiar with. If you just pick up that shape and we take it and we rest it, say, at the fifth fret, starting on the fifth string, you get this. Now, to make that's the seventh section, seventh component of this chord. Now, if you were to add this finger here, there, you would have a D9 chord. Okay, and remember I said that a D9 chord is basically the whole of a D7th plus one more note, and that note's the 9. So we've got basically a 7th component and this 9. So if we take this note and we move it up one fret, if that was the 9, this is the sharp 9. So then we've got this 7th component plus this note, which is a sharp 9. Hence, 7 sharp 9. Okay, so where can we use a 7 sharp 9? Well, one of the most popular places to use it is after the turnaround, as the final kind of strum of the 5 chord. So we would be going like, so you can use it there as a slight adjustment to the 5 chord. Another place you can use it is going from the 5 chord back down to the 4 chord. Ordinarily, when moving from the 5 chord to the 4 chord, you probably play something like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 2, 3, 4, before heading back to the 1 chord. Okay, But instead, this time, let's insert a 7 sharp 9 chord between our E9 and our D7. We're going to put an E flat 7 sharp 9. So then it sounds like this. Next up, we have the 7 flat 9 chord. Now, if this was a 9th chord, and we do this with that last 9 note, we're flattening the 9, so we've got this 7 component and a flat 9, so it sounds like this. So quite often, a 7 flat 9 chord can be used on the last beat of the bar of the 4 chord before it goes back to the 1 chord. So instead of, say, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, it will probably sound more like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. So you're getting that? Between the D9 and the D7 flat 9 before going to the A7. So yeah, it's usually on the 4 just before you switch to the 1 chord. Earlier on, we talked about 9th chords, and one interesting fact about 9th chords that you may not know is that they have a twin. Not an identical twin, but a twin nonetheless. And that twin chord is the minor 7 flat 5. Minor 7 flat 5 sounds like this. Not the sweetest or most friendly sounding chord, but what you'll learn from this lesson is that all of these chords that we cover today are ones that don't get played for very long and are often played just before the change to a more friendly, more familiar sounding chord. And the minor 7 flat 5 is no exception. The rules for using them as a pair is the 9th chord, for in this example, our D9 chord. To pair it with a minor 7 flat 5, the minor 7 flat 5 is played 4 frets higher than the root of your D9. So here's our D9. Okay, and here's the root of our D9, so we need to move up 4 frets. 1, 2, 3, 4, and play a minor 7 flat 5. So in a slow blues, for example, you might play something very straight like. Whereas now you can use the pairing to sound like this. Or you can even extend that by once you've landed here at the F sharp minor 7 flat 5, you can then move that up another 3 frets, 1, 2, 3, to give some very dark tension before the change back to the A7, which I'm playing right up here at the 12th fret. So that would sound like. Here's another dark sounding chord, the diminished 7th chord. Diminished 7th chords are great chords to use. As you probably heard in other blues players, the diminished sound is used a lot in blues. So where can we use this weird sounding diminished 7th chord? Well, you can use it before the 4 chord in the change from the 1 chord to the 4 chord. And like I said, these chords don't stick around long, so it's either like half a bar's worth or even a quarter of a bar that it spends on this chord. So let's take a look at a change from an A7 to a D7. We can insert the diminished 7 on the 4. Before the change, so we can go 1, 2, 3, 4. Or you could put it on the 3 and have it last half a bar. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. Up to you. Another way of using the diminished chord is to use it before the 1 when you're returning from the 4 chord back to the 1 chord. Sounds like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. So I was using this diminished 7th chord, which is an A flat diminished 7. So I just played it higher up. And then I resolved to this A7, but as you can hear, it's a slightly higher up one voicing than that one. But that's another great way you can use the diminished 7th. So combining a few of these tricks, we could have something that sounds like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2. Pretty cool, eh? Okay, now let's talk about the augmented chord. Augmented chord sounds like this. And it has that bond tension, that kind of mystery sound. Where can we use that? Well, quite commonly, you can use it as the 5 chord. So we're going from, say, the 5 chord. Back to the 4 chord. And then we're doing the 1 and then turning it around. There you go. So that last chime of the 5 chord, you can use an augmented chord instead. Now, what about 7 sharp 5? 7 sharp 5 sounds like this. Here's an A7 sharp 5. You can use a 7 sharp 5 chord before the 4 chord. So in this example, we're going to go A7, A7 sharp 5 to D7, like this. 1, 2, 3, 4. Another one we can use is the 7 flat 5. So here is a 7 flat 5. Yes, a lot more dissonant there. And again, it doesn't hang around long before changing to something else. We can use it for the same thing, putting it before the 4 chord. So A7 to D7, but with an A7 flat 5 in between. Like this. 1, 2, I'm using this alternative fingering of a D7 chord rather than the traditional bar chord shape with its root on the 5th string. So today we've covered 9th chords, 7 sharp 9 chords, 7 flat 9 chords, diminished 7th chords, augmented chords, and 7 flat 5 chords. All ones that you can put in your back pocket to sound more sophisticated. So that's all for today's lesson. I hope that lesson went some way to demystifying some of these weird chords and actually their application. If you've enjoyed this lesson, then give me a thumbs up, leave me a comment, tell me how you're going to apply what you've learned today in what you're going to be doing in the future. You can download the worksheet from the link below and subscribe if you want to hear more from me. This is Phil from 15 Minute Guitar Practice, saying bye for now. Cheers.